Take the roll.
Calling the roll, Mr. Schron.
Here.
Mr. Harrison. Mr. Harrison is absent. Mr. Tuma.
Here.
Ms. Baker.
Here.
Ms. Simon.
Here.
We have a quorum, and I'd like the record to reflect that Mr. Miller is in attendance.
Thank you. Welcome, Mr. Miller. Has there been any public comment related to the agenda?
No, Mr. Chair. No one has signed in.
Okay. And does everybody have a chance to look at the minutes from the February 23rd meeting? The chair will move that we approve the minutes from the February 23rd meeting. Is there a second?
Second.
It's been seconded. Any discussion regards to the minutes? Hearing no discussion. All in favor, say aye. Aye. Any abstention? And one abstention. Very good. We have one matter, looks like, on the agenda to bring before the committee. So if you could read this into the record, please.
Resolution 2017-0063, authorizing an economic development fund special large-scale attraction forgivable loan in the amount not to exceed $480,000 to Seven Signal Solution Incorporated for the benefit of a project located at 6155 Rockside Road in the City of Independence.
And is there someone here from economic development that's going to be talking on this?
Yes.
Mr. Carter?
Morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. I'm pleased to present the legislative packet this afternoon for Seven Signal, which is a Wi-Fi management technology company that represents a unique opportunity to bring technology from Summit County to Cuyahoga County. The deal structure has several dimensions that justify the departure from our standing programs in the creation of this pilot. One, bringing a company in from a neighboring county. Two, it is a high-tech company that has investors from various venture capital funds, several of which are Cleveland-based, including Jumpstart. Three, choosing Cuyahoga County because of their confidence in their ability to source technology talent here in Cuyahoga County. Four, high-wage jobs. Our partnership with the City of Independence, which is one of the county's business centers. And lastly, there's a foreign direct investment element in its origins, which is part of our go-forward strategy in terms of growing the county. Our timeline was pretty aggressive, and so it went from a referral to us to engage this company through our due diligence process with a final review and approval by the county's external investment review committee. I'm joined here today by Tom Barrett, the CEO of the company, who will provide a short overview. Mayor Tagliati, the Mayor of Independence, and his economic development team, without whose partnership this would not have had this opportunity. And lastly, Michael May, who will provide a short overview of the technical elements of the deal. I want to thank Mike and his team for being willing to go outside of the box and our standing programs to help secure this opportunity. Now, the basis of this deal is a forgivable loan. While not unusual, is sometimes utilized in limited circumstances. So we provided you with a sheet in your package that shows a side-by-side comparison of the second type of pilot program that we developed, again, which is not part of our standing programs, but part of the feedback we've gotten from the private sector and the marketplace is that at times our process takes too long and they were not flexible enough in terms of meeting market opportunities. So both of these projects and Sterigenics was not approved by this body, went through the Board of Control due to the amount of capital that was provided, which was underneath the threshold, which required council approval. But both of these programs were fast-tracked. We were reacted to an opportunity in the marketplace to secure these companies' presence here in Cuyahoga County. And so I'm very, very pleased that we were able to be responsive enough to meet the company's timelines. In this instance, forgivable loan is part of an inducement package to encourage Seven Signal to sign a lease in Independence and no longer consider a competitive package that they have from the City of Akron. Our analysis shows that this project will yield a positive return on investment to the county of just over 2-to-1. And it's also, the loan is, though forgivable, is backed by a corporate guarantee and it's performance-based with certain clawbacks. I would end by saying that, again, I'm pleased with the department's performance engagement with this company to secure this to reach a stage in negotiation which we could put this forward, project forward for adoption by the council. I'd like to thank Executive Budish for giving us a green light to be creative and go outside the box in terms of our negotiations, the Economic Development Team for its creativity, and the City of Independence for partnering with us. The mayor and his team have been terrific to work for, and this is a model that we want to continue across the county as we work with the 59 communities to both attract and expand businesses within the county. At this time, I'd like Mr. Barrett to come up and do a quick overview so it gives you some context for the company and their approach to this technology, which is pretty exciting. And then Mayor Tagliati will come up, and then Mike May will walk through the deal terms very quickly.
Great. Thank you. Can you all see this yet?
Not yet.
All right. First of all, I wanted to thank the county and the City of Independence. This is a awesome opportunity to bring a high-growth, cutting-edge technology company to Cuyahoga County. And just to give you a little bit of background about the company, we are VC-funded. The primary venture capitalists are Jumpstart, Mutual Capital Partners, Allos Ventures out of Cincinnati, North Coast Angels also out of Cleveland, and a whole host of individuals that go along with that. From a product evolution standpoint, you know, the company was started in Finland by two Nokia engineers and brought the technology to Akron by a program they had, which was a bridges program to bring technology companies back and really leverage the IP that was in Akron for Wi-Fi companies. So as you can see from a product, you know, evolution standpoint, we started as a sensor you would put in a ceiling, much like an access point that may be in this room for Wi-Fi. And then over time, it's grown. So what we are doing is giving IT departments vision into end-user Wi-Fi experiences in every vertical market. And when you think of our markets, and they truly are in every vertical from hospital, manufacturing, what I call enterprise, which is just about everybody else, and high-end retail. The market's growing from a distribution warehouse perspective. The mission-critical applications that we're addressing are truly life and death. So when you think of a hospital, a nurse's cart, blood drip monitors, everything now is moving to Wi-Fi, and what we're doing is connecting them. If you think of Wi-Fi, unlike what we probably use for free on a Panera, not our target market. Ours is mission critical. People transacting, running credit cards, you know, running machines, lights out manufacturing, and anything that has a Wi-Fi connection to it is where we fit. From a an example. So if you think of a retail store, Gap is one of our clients. 2015, in a retail store, you had a handful of Wi-Fi signals happening. In the back of the store, there's a cash register. That's where you transact business. And you fast forward to 2020, suddenly it's all over the place, right? The sales associates now use iPads. They're out on the floor. They're swiping credit cards. If the credit card doesn't go through, they can't sell. Then you also have noisy neighbors. You have Abercrombie next door, you have the free Wi-Fi in the mall, all of that air gets crowded and impacts their ability to work. Okay, so the Gap is growing like crazy. And then also, when you think of our enterprise solution, this is very interesting to see also. Think of a meeting 2015, a couple of people, phones, computers hitting the Wi-Fi, not that big of a deal. And then now in 2020, everybody has multiple devices. You have noisy people above you, below you, next to you. The Wi-Fi is critical for the meeting, but yet the air is congested. So our solution lets IT manage this and fix it before people even know there's something wrong. And then at the end, what do they get? So IT departments get a nice vision, and they are able to now manage their wired networks, companies like ServiceNow and Splunk and some of these others that do it, and then right next to it, they can see their Wi-Fi network. If they wanted, we could put them both together into one interface. So now, from call it mission control, they can have a pulse on their Wi-Fi network around the world real time. So that's the concept of what we're doing. It's, again, proactive Wi-Fi. And here's how it works, you know, from a just a graphical interface. So we have a piece of hardware called a Sapphire, and we also have software that we put on the devices. So we can do both. We can monitor and manage things when they're in a campus environment, but more importantly, when they start to move around and people travel around the world, they also are able to keep their finger on the pulse of what the end user experiences for Wi-Fi, which is our differentiator. 4 years ago, we had 3 competitors. Now there's about 22, and then we're clearly the leader. And for, you know, I've been part of several early stage high growth companies, and none of them had a customer list like this. So we're selling to the biggest companies in the world. They're buying the product, and we continue to grow. Q1 of this year, which we just finished, we did 1.289 million. It's a little, about 65% growth over Q1 last year, with really one productive salesperson. Now we have 5. They're still ramping up. So the customer list, and you can see they continue to buy. So Booz Allen has been buying for 16 months now, several $100,000 a year. We're built into their buildouts. And if you look at our forecast for Q2, again, conservatively 1-1, and the customer list continue to grow and evolve. So this is, in my opinion, the highest growth company in Northeast Ohio. We're the only ones that do this in the world the way we do it. And we currently have 7 patents and 3 more pending, and with very ambitious growth goals. Moving to independence will help us in a few different ways. One is being able to find talented IT professionals from a developer standpoint. And independence, I'm able to pull from Akron, Cleveland East, Cleveland West, and South, and purely just sourcing job talent. We also have several of our associates are out of town, so coming in and out of town quite a bit, closer to the airport. And then we do several customer events, and they keep getting larger. So we host those. So being closer to the city really helps. From an employee standpoint, we're at 25. I've added 7 in the last 3 months. I just hired a new chief technology officer that starts at the end of the month. He's coming up from Columbus. He's moving his family. He's currently an executive with The Gap. And then we still have 2 employees in Finland, 2 developers, so a total of 25. And we continue to evolve and grow. Being able to work with the universities will be helpful, working with the county, figuring out what kind of resources we can get that can handle tier 2 support, as well as the traditional developer roles. So that's it in 10 minutes or less. If you have any questions, I'm happy to take them.
We intend to go through what, 4 procedures, 4 presentations? Yes. So just because you're off the stage doesn't mean you're off the stage.
Okay.
So. Thanks. So I was just add 2 comments to what Mr. Barrett went through, is that this is the type of company that we want to have as part of our, as we develop the ecosystem of the county from a business diversity standpoint. And again, one of the most compelling things for us to take this approach in negotiating this deal was, again, the labor force component. You know, there's a narrative in Northeast Ohio, Cuyahoga County, that companies cannot find IT talent here in order to grow. And so to have the opportunity to bring a company here that says they believe they can, we will help support them with that with our Skill Up program is a pretty compelling, was a pretty compelling piece of the justification here. The second one was the partnership with the City of Independence, who had already gone down the path of talking with Tom and had a site that he loved in terms of leased space. So I want to have Mayor Tagliati come up and talk about what this means for the City of Independence, the capital that they are contributing to the deal, and then we'll go through the fine print.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Chairman and committee members. I'm here today to represent the City of Independence and to express our support and optimism on Seven Signal's relocation to the City of Independence. About 2 years ago, the City of Independence completed a economic development strategic plan. And within that strategic plan, it highlighted industry sectors that are growing and that the City of Independence is currently strong in, but can be built upon, and IT, internet technologies, was one of those sectors that was identified, and we have been working very steadfastly to increase that market sector in the City of Independence. We've been increasing our fiber optic networks throughout the city. We currently have a $14 million data center that is going to be completed in the next 2 months. And with the addition of 7 Signal, it will help to expand that economic ecosystem and workforce that we desire to attract to the City of Independence. And as was mentioned earlier, it's not only these 25 jobs that they have now, but the demand for the service and products that they're providing is phenomenal, and the future growth outlook is tremendous. So we're looking forward to bringing in high-quality employees to the City of Independence, as well as bringing in their clients and customers to help fill our hotels and restaurants and event centers. So it's really a win-win for the city, and we are financially vested in this this relocation. My city council recently approved a economic incentive package, which includes a upfront relocation grant, as well as some income tax revenue refunds over the course of a number of years. And my economic development director, Jeremy Rowan, could share the specifics of that with you. As I said, I'm here to express our support, and I hope that you will consider this package for 7 Signal. Thank you.
Chairman, Council, I'm Michael May, head the Economic Development Division of the Department of Development. Just in broad brush, I wanted to give you the terms of the loan. This forgivable loan does emanate from a pilot program that we had created back in late last year to meet the need and the opportunity that we had with Sterigenics out of the Chicago area. The program, you do have in a packet that we sent you showing the comparison of the Sterigenics package and the 7 Signal Solutions opportunity that we had before us that was sent to you. I'm not sure if you have it in front of you, but basically the terms, again, emanate from that program. And in the 7 Signal instance, we are offering a $480,000 forgivable loan that would bear interest of 2% per annum, would be deferred. The principal and interest would be deferred over a 7-year period, upon which, if at the end of the 7-year period, the company has done two things. One is created a number of jobs, 48, in fact, in 3 years, and then maintained those jobs and maintained itself in Cuyahoga County, stayed here through year 7, both the principal and interest on the loan would be forgiven in total. Basically, the financing is part of a $4 million package, relocations, scale-up, moving package from Akron, the Akron Global Accelerator, to some targeted lease space that they have. They've zeroed in on Rockside Road in Independence, about 3,800 square feet that they would be moving into once they sign that lease. And to, again, do over the course of the next couple of years, about a $4 million investment in effectuating that move. We're providing $480,000 of that $4 million package. It basically is a scale up. It would be going toward a whole series of things: move costs, FF&E expenditures, new hardware and software platforms, and other sundry components of the investment that they'd be putting in. They again will be, as Tom indicated, they'd be bringing 25 employees here. So those are new to Cuyahoga County jobs, i.e. defined as job created or jobs created, and then they would be adding another 23 positions. The positions would have average salaries of $100,000, which was a key component of the pilot and the reasoning behind being willing to do forgivable on this is to bring those kinds of high technical and well-paying jobs, and that's just the salaries, that's not the benefits, but that's the threshold that we've applied to where the level of economic development that we want to see in order to provide this kind of basically $10,000 per job. This type of job is the arithmetic that we're using to determine how much money that they can get. Also, we have some thresholds with regard to we won't do more than 25% of the project, and other sundry specifics or specifications that we need in order for them to qualify. So I believe that's the overview. If you have other questions, I'm happy to answer them.
Do you want to cover what Independence is putting into this, or do you would you rather have Independence?
I can just in general. I can say that they are, as the mayor indicated, they are providing a job retention and a job attraction and a grant and a tax credit for the payrolls that are going to be generated there over the next 3 years. And that would be, Jerry Maron, the ED director, can explain the sort of the ins and outs of it, but basically it would amount to something that would be valued as much as $200,000with that tool from Independence. So,
what's the grant?
Can I explain that, Jerry?
The way that we structured our incentive for Seven Signal is really it's two components. First, there's some upfront dollars that are tied to two separate $50,000 payments. So when Seven Signal moves into the City of Independence 90 days after they receive their certificate of occupancy on office space, the city would issue them a check for $50,000.
As a grant. Okay.
Then after they're in for the remainder of this calendar year, we would ask them to, again, provide some payroll documentation that we would confirm through RITA. And once we've done that, verifying that they brought the employees that they said they would, we would give them, again, another grant of $50,000. And then the second component of the incentive is based on payroll performance. So we would, Seven Signal would be in Independence in all of 2018 and 2019. So based on the amount of income tax that is contributed to the city, the 2% that they pay in payroll withholdings, the city agrees to, for those two calendar years, provide them a grant equal to 50% of that amount. And our estimate based on working with the company, based on their payroll projections, it would be up to an estimate of about $200,000 total.
That's on top of the 250s?
That includes the 250.
Okay, so it's going to cap out?
There is no cap. So if they grow more than they anticipate, and the city realizes a larger payroll collection, then that would be shared back with the company as part of this, so there is no cap. So that's when we describe our grants, we use the word estimate ahead of them because they're really based on payroll. We do establish a minimum, which is what they'd be bringing into the city, and they've agreed not to dip below that or go into default with us. Another term of our agreement with them is that they remain in the city for 7 years. And if they were to relocate out of the city of Independence within that 7 years, there's a repayment mechanism built into the agreement.
And is that incorporated into ours also?
It is, yes.
Okay, all right. And so that, just to get make sure I have the terms before we start going up and down the road, just to make sure we have all the terms. Do you have any guarantees on your payments?
We do not require, we don't have guarantees because the loan structure is different. Really, our payments are triggered by events, so they have to pay in. They have to pay into a minimum before they get something back from us. So it's different than the vehicle that the county is using. So that's why.
Just curious as to where you would, if you did, where would you be in the pecking order? So I was going to try and get to.
Okay, yeah. Fair enough.
Okay, now that we've got the deal in front of us, now that we have Mr. Barrett, Ms. May, already having spoken in regards to this. The mayor, Taglioni, and Mr. Carter, is there any questions from the committee before? Yes.
Thank you.
If you can identify who you'd like up there, or is it?
This actually probably to the mayor and I guess it would be the head of the company of
Mr. Barrett.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. This is to either of you two gentlemen. How did you find each other, if you will, you know, to get together? Who was it? The county that brought, you know, your company to the city, or the city find you and bring you to the county? How did this all pan out?
So, introduction to Jeremy from Mr. Schron.
From Mr. Schron. Oh, okay. Well, a little closer than we thought. Okay, no, that's fine. So it was Mr. Schron then introduced to each other.
Yes.
Okay. Right. Fair enough. And then
but that doesn't mean I still won't ask tough questions. So please don't misinterpret, as Mr. Carter knows.
No, that's perfectly fine. That's perfectly fine. Then, as far as your company, what separates you from other types of companies? You said there's a lot of competition. You had, I think you said, like 22 other companies have sprouted up along these lines. So, what, you know, why your company versus another company for this venture with the county?
I can handle these questions.
So okay, well.
First of all, competition's great for us. So you want competitors, right? That validates the space. And our competitors are Cisco and HP and Aruba. But where they stop is where we begin. So they, if you think of their products, they go in the ceiling. And they can manage your access, your Wi-Fi, back all the way through your network and firewall. What they can't see is you're down to your device. And what's going on between here and the ceiling. So mm-hmm. the last 50 feet, which is what we have patented. And, you know, over time, those companies are obviously, you know, potential acquirers of the company. So so that that's why customers, you know, competitors are also your best friends sometimes. So we work together on deals also, mm-hmm. Because the end customer needs both.
Okay, and then what potential location are you guys looking to move into as far as at least space?
6155 on Rockside, right next to the Holiday Inn.
Okay.
I think it's Rockside Square, I believe.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Ms. Simon?
So that was one of my questions about the location. Are you redeveloping existing buildings? Or are you...
It is. It's not significant as far as construction. It's 3,655 square feet, and it's paint, carpet, wiring. That's pretty much it. It's just a wide open square.
Okay, and collateral. It seems we're getting a priority lien on some collateral of furniture and. Yeah. I'm sure you've assessed the value of this.
Well, we'll know what it's purchased for because we are providing most of our money for the physical components, both the fix up the furniture, fixtures and equipment, and IT improvements that will also be going into the package or into the project. So that amounts to about $450,000 of that kind of investment, much of which we will put a lien on. But again, first, the key here is the corporate guarantee. Basically, this is going to be backed and fully guaranteed by the corporation itself. So that's the securitization.
So you're comfortable with the company, obviously, rather than personal
yes.
guarantee. Company's healthy and,
right.
and yeah.
Correct. It's a 10-year-old company, 10-year, 9-year-old company?
It's
a 10-year-old
business.
Yeah, 10-year-old business. That's what we have in the way of collateral.
So we'll get some UCC-1 filings or something on the collateral?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. That's it for now.
Yes. Ms. Baker?
All right. Thank you. Well, let's see. I guess to the owner.
I think you just got promoted to the owner, but I don't think that's probably the case.
Well,
I'm an owner.
And that's part of my question here is that it says principal owners, Alloys Ventures Funds and Multiple Venture Capital Funds, 29% and 19%, which equal to 48%. So who are the other 52% that...
North Coast Angels and about 30 individuals that are also investors in North Coast Angels and Mutual Capital Partners, and most of them are Northeast Ohio people.
I may continue.
Joe, yeah, please. You don't even ask permission. Just go.
Thanks. So there is no controlling interest. There isn't
anyone. Not from one single entity.
Not from a single. Okay. The Jumpstart, can you tell me what their investment is?
Sure. It's two different funds, and I think in total it's a little over $500,000.
Is that just a pure investment, or is there...
It's equity, right.
It's equity. Okay. You know, whenever I see big numbers go from one year to the next, you do have to kind of scratch your head a bit. In 2016, you were approximately $2 million, and you predict by the end of 2019, that you will be $20 million. So you're going from a $2 million and increasing $18 million. Is that, you know, how realistic is that?
It's conservative. So 100% growth a year is very doable. And here's an example. So we've already done, I call it $1.2 million in the first quarter with one salesperson. We have six. The other five have just been hired in the last 45 days, as well as our current customers continue to evolve and grow. So although the company's 10 years old, they've really only been selling for 4 years, but really selling for a year and a half. It's growth mode. So we're poised for great things. Because when the market... at least in the last 18 months, the mission critical Wi-Fi has grown exponentially. So we were ahead of it for a while, but now the markets have caught up, mission critical and banking and manufacturing and healthcare. Yeah. So in the past, it was nice to have. Now it's a must to have.
You know, speaking of that, the patent that you have that gives you the edge over your competitors, how time tested is that? As we all know,
there are seven.
Well, there's seven, but as we know, IT changes all the time, and variations of your patent could be.
Sure.
So how do you see yourself protecting your patent and the changes that will be 5 years from now or 10 years from now or maybe less?
So in the process with three more. So as the products evolve and change also with the, and actually this month we're releasing our product for Windows, and then next month it's Mac. So it's never ending. So the seven were really good to get us where we are, but where we're going is a whole other direction.
And you don't feel that your competitors, when they see the growth of 2 million to 20 million, and that's a conservative number, that they won't jump on with their resources and try to take it from you?
Oh, sure. I would expect they would try.
Okay.
Which is a good thing, by the way. So you want them to do that.
Yeah. I just wonder if you think you can be competitive enough with the resources you have against those that have billions of dollars in their war chest to be able to take advantage of what you've been able to do.
Right. So still a $25 million business is a tiny component to what a Cisco is, right? It's more of an add-on to what one of their core products is. So we're on the radar, but we're not enough to have a company change strategies to go try to manage the Wi-Fi space. They make their business on hardware and systems and support.
Okay. With any IT company, usually location doesn't matter because you can be anywhere, you can communicate anywhere, you can go anywhere. So why is it, and I heard your explanation of you're closer to the airport and you're closer to perhaps the people that you would invest in, but really outside of that, why is it that in the IT world where you can go anywhere and speak anywhere, and really that's the value of who you are, why is it important to go to Independence?
Really for two reasons, for current and future employees. So developers are hard to come by no matter where you are in the country, much less Northeast Ohio. So when I'm in Akron, to get a developer to come from Westlake to Akron, where I could pay them the same wage, is too hard. They're not going to do it. Mm. If I can move closer, I can keep my employees, I'm halfway, and I can pull from the East and West and really almost triple my applicants, which is still going to be a chore because that tech talent's very difficult.
I had something else here. I don't know if who this would be, but someone mentioned clawbacks and benchmarks and all those kind of things. Do we have something that is illustrated that shows what the benchmarks are? And
well, the benchmarks are fairly simple.
again, they're the creation of, or the bringing in of jobs and creation of jobs to the tune of, over the course of 3 years, 48 jobs, and then keeping those jobs intact for the next 4 years, i.e. the full 7 years. So that's the major piece here. The other issue is, and we will monitor it, we monitor those employee, by the way, counts each and every year. We'll get a list out of the employees that are there now, what salaries they have once the loan is closed and the project is underway. Then we will each and every year go out and sort of get a listing of 7 or 8 fields of information on those employees, basically tracking what's going on there. At the same time, we'll know the progress of the project, in that number one, we, as most of the people, decision makers that have been here for a while, they know that we work on a reimbursement basis. So basically, we don't front the money. We basically make the borrower make the expenditure and then come to us with the backup and the numbers and the invoices of what they've expended, and we'll reimburse if it's according to the makeup of what the budget is. That's pretty much it. In terms of clawback, they number one, again, have guaranteed this loan. That's why we kept it as a loan, because that gives us the ability to put UCC liens to basically securitize this thing in a stronger way than if it was simply a grant that we then would want to try to claw back and have to sue them for that. Yeah. So. Nonetheless, there are in our contracts, there are all kinds of protections with regard to our pursuit of somebody that doesn't, say they move out of the county within 2 years. We would again foreclose on them, and we would pursue them legally, all of which is built into our contracts. They basically, for example, forego the ability to do a jury trial. They have to go right to court. The corporate guarantee actually is an admission, basically, or an agreement to basically accept the summary judgment, so we wouldn't even have to go through for a trial. Again, there are all kinds of mechanisms built into into the contract and into our methodology of following the course of or the progress of and whether those benchmarks have been met. So that's again broad brush. There's a pretty thick contract that goes right with all that, but. That has us protected pretty well.
All of this, in the terms that are stated, is a 7-year scenario. So
yes.
It looks like that if the commitment of 48 jobs, which 25 are already within that 48,
correct.
So we're talking about an additional 23.
Yeah, correct.
So
but again, I think it's really important. We have defined this is about attraction and getting those jobs across the border inside of Cuyahoga County. So
yeah.
It really is important, I think, at least, you know, from our programmatic standpoint, and it has been for the last, you know, the policy here of the county to count that as a created job. And then on top of that, we're having, the augmentation of that employment staff, another 23. So it's an important get,
right,
if you will, for Cuyahoga County.
The additional 23 that are potentially coming within the 7 years.
Right. Actually 3 years.
Within 3 years.
They actually have to do this within 3 years.
So, you know, that gray area of, well, we didn't quite get to 48, we got to 35.
Yeah, we have. Well,
yeah, how do you have it where? Because that's the hardest part when you have something like this.
It is difficult, but again, over time, we have actually built in sort of a way to basically give them some ability to explain, number one. I mean, basically, there are certain circumstances, the economy completely tanking, force majeure, you name it, those kinds of uncontrollable circumstances, those are things we've built into the language of the contract. Basically, we will listen. So again, we have the power to claw back, to foreclose, to sue. We do say we'll listen, and listen to the sort of reasoning behind why they may have only reached 35 jobs, and then at our discretion decide whether that's going to be number one, a good enough story, and secondly, then to create the okay, well, what are we going to do for the next? You know, we'll construct something that says for the next year or two or three, we'll determine, okay, here are the new benchmarks that we'll do. So we do put some flexibility into the formula and into the document.
Do you have a drop dead if you're not meeting this 48?
Yes. Yeah, we have date. We have, again, they have to notify us ahead of time if there are problems. We then give them, 60 days to come up with a plan as to what they're going to do next. And again, it's all sort of calibrated within the, you know, sort of the real world of what's happening at that moment.
Right. It sounds labor intensive for your department to keep an eye on what it is that they're doing. Do you have the resources and the?
We could always use more councilwoman. I think we've mechanized this pretty well so that, and we work obviously heavily with the law department. So their attorneys are we're negotiating these deals. And again, this after the legislation, if and when it is passed, we then sit down and both our lawyers negotiate a hard agreement on this. So a lot of that weight falls on the law department, although again, I especially am heavily involved in those negotiations and the language that's effectuated in the agreement. We certainly have plugged and are covering the major, most important bases in this formula.
It's probably not in this packet, but do you have that written where, is it every 6 months, year, every other year? How often do you communicate with
it's
this company?
It's written in the contract that each and every year.
Every year.
They give us a starting point, how many jobs they have at the get-go. And then each and every year we have a monitoring compliance of person and a half that basically, right now actually that's happening. We're going out, we're getting back the job numbers from the borrowers that we have at this point. But it's all... Again, it's very user friendly. It's very understandable. It's basically spreadsheets that are electronically given to the borrower so that they will fill out those six columns of information, the names and the salaries. And
is the responsibility on the company, or do you trigger something that will say?
Well, we regularly give them a warning at the end of the year. We then. They have until March to provide the actual information. We're going at them and telling them this. You'll recall in your agreement, you have to send us this information. Here's the format it must be in as a reminder. And then you have so many days to get that back to us. And then if they fail, we take round two and we go at them more strongly. Visit with them. To get the information that we need.
The other investors, if they're government investors like Jumpstart, mm-hmm. Are there provisions in place for them that would also put a burden on the return on investment that would make it just a little more difficult to meet everyone's need because everyone's protecting themselves?
Sure. It's at some point, companies are leveraged and they've got different they've got different lenders or equity investors. We do get their financials. We know what loans and equity investments they have. That this, by the way, went through our Community Improvement Corporation Loan Review Committee back in on March 8th. So the members of the committee, several of which are bankers, went through all of the financials to look at the leveraging situation and who all else is there. We do blanket liens on everything. We basically put as strong a set of securities as we can on thing. It is a bit of an issue though with regard to all the lenders.
Right. Where are we in line for getting our funds if something were to be short in collecting?
We'd be first on.
We're first.
On the assets, and again with the corporate guarantee, basically it's I can't say we're absolutely first. We're just part of the group that's looking for guarantees. I don't know if any of the other equity investors have required corporate guarantees.
Maybe that would be a question to ask. You have quite a few people or corporations, angels, that are investing in yours. In fact, there's no real, there is no over 50%.
The state of Ohio is first, so.
State of Ohio is first, okay. And so I'm sure state of Ohio certainly has its clawback and, you know, what happens, all the what ifs. So are we behind the state of Ohio?
This whole proposal mirrors the state's requirements for jobs, and it's not anything more or less, it's exact.
Okay, that's good to know.
We always, and we'll attempt here, we try for a shared first. And again, it's right. Not always successful, but we do work with that. And again, we're, with regard to that's an older loan, and that has to do with what's gone before. And so what we're doing now is from this standing start, securitizing what our money is going toward.
Right. One last question for now. Mr. Carter, you stated that Independence was a business center for the county. Do we have specific cities that are designated as business centers?
Oh, not officially, but they are certainly part of the counties that businesses seek to go to. So when you look at where employers and companies land, Independence would certainly be one of them. And so there's no official designation as a business center, but where you see the natural kind of affinity for companies to grow and locate.
Hmm. Okay, because I'm sure there's a lot of cities out there that would hope to be able to attract a company like this that may not be on your radar. Okay.
That's it. Okay.
It's good for Independence. You know, winners and losers are.
Yeah,
it's tough to, you know, for these cities that are struggling that would like to have had a chance to have this in their city.
It's a great question, Councilwoman. What I would say is that we don't drive where businesses go. We may have a preference, or we may say, have you thought about this? But they had already done their market analysis of what made sense for their company, the labor considerations that Mr. Barrett talked about.
Right.
Independence engaged us, and then we structured something. So we're not picking winners or losers, okay, necessarily, or telling a company you must go here if you want the county's investment. That wouldn't be entirely true. There are times where we have a strong preference, and I think this time we did suggest some other locations, and as we did with Sterigenics, and the company demurred, say, this is what our real estate analysis has shown us, that if you want us in Cuyahoga County, this is where we want to go. Yeah. Work with us to make it work, and so that's really the process. I understand your point.
Right, and it should be a private sector decision, right. Not government.
Right.
That's all for now.
Thank you. Sammy J, follow up before I get started?
Just a quick question about the employee pool from you, Mr. Barrett.
Sure.
Please. So you said there's still a scarcity of the high skilled level of employees, mm-hmm, that you would be looking for. Is that because of where we're located in Cleveland? I'm sure out West Coast or right.
So, but it's a problem across the country.
Really?
It's less of a problem in San Francisco and some other hotbeds, but it's still a problem. And it's also, the wages also go up when you go on the coast as well, when the skill sets are there. But we had 3 developer jobs open for over 9 months with really no qualified applicants. And now I've brought in 2, one from Columbus and one from Elyria, because we've committed to moving closer. And they're, early 30s, late 20s. So it's a function of just pure the number of people that you can attract.
If there's a dearth of employees and there's a demand, what's going on? I mean, why aren't people getting skilled up in this?
That's a great question. I'm probably not qualified to answer that.
I mean, it's just interesting. Right. It's just interesting. Okay.
But they're actually really hard jobs too.
Yeah, but there's smart people all over.
Right. Hey, I'll hire them.
Okay. That's it.
Okay.
Thanks.
Any other? Yep.
What level of risk would you say
this decision is in allowing? Are you really, wow, this is quite a catch, we're at 90 plus, or it's a tick, you know, maybe we're a little better, like 60, or, and it does worry me a little bit from the 2 to 20, if I don't know if that was on your radar. Where are you in your comfort level for this project?
Yeah, there's definitely risk here, as it is, but three things gave us comfort in taking putting this forward. One is that they've been around for a while, so they're really second stage. They're not a startup company. Two is the investors that have already scrutinized them and deployed capital. And then three is, as we went through a version of an overview of the company, the technology space that they're in. Now, we're not technology experts, but I have some familiarity with this product. When I was in Jacksonville, the stadium that we owned, the NFL mandated that the city augment our Wi-Fi capability for game day because everyone's on those fantasy football things. And so something like this, Mr. Barrett actually did an illustration of our Wi-Fi capability in our conference room. And so, you know, we, as part of our plan, really want to be at the cutting edge of developing industries of the future. And so it does get to the labor question. And so we want to connect a labor force and a pool to create that type of demand. But there's risk here. There's no question about it. But I think that's our job, to take prudent risk. And we think that this falls in that category.
So if I may ask, prudent risk, are you 80% in, 90% in? How confident are you? And if I can also maybe add to that question, as I did earlier, the whole, you know, IT world changes every day. And although we have some great patents that were illustrated in your office, any concern that, you know, those patents can be evolving and changing and that they really will be not as valuable as they are today? Although I'm sure this company will always be on the cutting edge of trying to do bigger and better. Any concern about that?
Well, there's concern, but I would say the fourth dimension of this is that, relatively speaking, it's a modest amount of money to some of the other things we've invested in. And so when you combine those things and that we're securitizing it, you know, to the extent we're comfortable, there's always the risk of failure. But again, one of the things that we are trying to inculcate in this community is that we are entrepreneurially oriented, and, you know, this city was founded on entrepreneurship, and so this is the industry of the future, you know. And so we think it's a prudent risk, not zero risk for sure. So if you gave me a confidence basis, I wouldn't be qualified 80. Okay. You know, we feel better about it than we don't. That was the way
I'd
put it.
Each year, I'm sure that percentage will go up as you see the return on investment.
Right. And if this company is successful, it'll build on itself, right? So it'll attract other technology companies. And we think that we definitely have a theory of the case that kind of the wage differential between Cleveland, Cuyahoga County, and the coast are going to work to our advantage over time if this company can be successful. And so they could have stayed in Akron. They chose to come here. So it's but I don't want to kid you. It's not like it's zero risk. I don't think you've been in the business where there's any home run, right?
Right.
So,
well, not,
or guarantee
not
anyway.
Yet. After you've made the home run, and it's a home run.
Right.
do you then, and just wrapping up, do you feel that you're, as I said earlier to Mr. May, do you feel your department has the resources and has in place what it's going to take to monitor this company on a yearly basis, whether they are proactive in giving it to you or whether you're going to be have to go out there and seek it out? Yeah. Do you feel good about having the resources and the people in place to do that?
Here's the way I'd answer that. We've got a good team, but we need to make it better, and we need to strengthen our compliance. So that is part of our game plan that we're happy to come back and drill into how that's going to take place. But at the moment, yes, but we've got to strengthen, continue to strengthen it and make improvements.
In this contract, though, have you given yourself this security of knowing that at least within this contract, if they're not proactive in reaching out to you, that you have the resources and it's on your radar?
Yes, certainly now as a result of your questions and the committee's questions, it will be at the top of the world list, yes.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Just from a personal statement standpoint, I've known Tom Barrett for 11, 12 years. He used to work at a little company that I was involved with called Tooling University, involved with sales and marketing behalf of it. So put that on the record. I had nothing to do with any of the negotiations. I did not know anything about any of the negotiations. Mr. Carter will attribute attest to that, and I think the mayor will attest to that. I did not get involved in any negotiations whatsoever as far as any of the deal or any of the background on it. I did do, based on a telephone call from Mr. Barrett, I did receive the telephone call. I recommended that he, what can I do to help try and get him into the county, because as you all, everybody knows, my attitude on poaching is not, it's not a problem to take anybody from any place outside of Cuyahoga County and bring them in here, out there. So I hope my friends in Summit County, if I ever run for anything that at a higher level, won't hold that against me. With that being said, I did not get involved in any aspects of it whatsoever as far as the deal or the structure and anything in regards to that. So I wanted to make sure I put that clearly on the record. And because we do have a plenty of quorum, plenty of votes here, one way or the other, not trying to suggest how it might turn out. I just to avoid any appearance of impropriety from our legal staff, I will not be voting in regards to this matter out there.
Mr. Yes. Chairman, you just made me think of one other thing to Ms. Baker's question, is that around risk. The way we also try to account for risk, so Mr. Barrett asked for a lot more money. So this was a negotiated process, and so we got him down to where we felt comfortable and where he would accept it. And so he can speak to how Akron approached him. But so we are mindful of the risk, and it just we don't let's let companies come in and say, we want X. There's always a back and forth and a negotiation that we arrive at a place within the context of our program. So that would be the fifth element of how we've managed risk here.
If I understand what I read, it's about 10% of the relocation move?
Right, yes.
Okay, now, some questions. I was aware of an email regarding the offer from Summit County in regards to this transaction. I became aware of it. It's now a public piece of information, public document. Because of that, now that it's in the county records, please describe what you were offered there, and is that deal still on the table in any way, shape, or form if this deal does not go through?
So the deal from Akron incorporated, I'm going to go by memory because I don't have the email in front of me, a couple different sources of funds, all of them in the commitment that I would stay in Summit County and specifically Akron, although there is this Jed area that's actually north of Akron that is an available space. Because they knew my goal was to get further north for the employee pool, so they were trying to help facilitate that. And they've been a fantastic partner, and I wrote them a very nice thank you note in the newspaper a week or two ago that we graduated, and that was a great thing. So their offer composed of, it was a very aggressive offer, so it was an incentive to stay, which included some amount of funds up front, some amount based on our employment growth, very similar to the state numbers, and then the exact dollar amount is probably a little bit more than what Cuyahoga and Independence is doing. This is not a purely financial decision, obviously. It's more for the what's best for the company, and the whole reason is to be closer to more people.
And that's why I want to put it, that their offer appeared to me to be greater than what's being presented between Independence and the county.
That's right.
Financially. Okay, so.
And there's also equity involved. So they have an entity that's that can invest money into the company that they have done in the past. It's separate from the city and county, but it's kind of like a jump start, but it's on a very small scale.
Okay. Actually, some other questions as far as deal structure. Is there any personal guarantee in regards to this deal?
No.
Okay. And then the rest of my, I think most of the rest of my questions are for economic development side of the aisle. This appears to be one of the largest forgivable loans as a percent of total of a deal that we've ever done in the 6 years.
No, actually, Mr. Chairman, the tool that we exclusively, frankly, up until now, use forgivability in is our redevelopment and modernization program, whereby we can do $1.5 million loan, but we will in fact forgive up to 35% of that loan if the building, if basically the reuse, the cleanup and reuse of a building is in play. In order to be able to get that piece of real estate back up to competitive level, we have the program again that sort of can speak to that. So we have in fact done 35% forgivables on occasion to that kind of a project.
But the dollar amount, we combine those two together, this is almost $500,000.
Well, some of those others are almost $500,000 as well.
Okay,
yeah. All right. More.
And if the company is sold, what happens at that point in time?
Immediately. Well, we have...
within the 7 year, before 7 years.
Yeah, we have built into the agreement or into the template, again, which we'll negotiate and fine-tune, but basically we are the... Basically, if the company is merged, is taken over, we basically then can be the judge. But in the scenario that the company that buys them is willing to stay in place, willing to keep doing what's going on in that scenario that we lent to, we at our discretion could decide to sort of leave things alone and go forward. If in fact, though, the company is bought and taken away, if they change their business, in large measure, all of those would trigger immediately the due and payable aspects of the loan, and in effect, clawback of the money immediately.
Okay, so that's a triggering event that calls for us to get paid. If they correct. Move to Poughkeepsie or someplace,
correct.
Then we have a right to get
yes.
our entire amount
yes.
back, plus the interest that's accrued.
Plus that interest, okay. right.
IT assets are not historically something that today's asset versus 7 years from now are going to be the same asset, worth mm-hmm. the same thing. How do we make sure we stay current with, because they're going to more than likely update, I would assume, some of those tech assets over the next 6-7 years?
We can, again, it will, it'll take some creativity, but basically we could sort of stay close to the upgrades and the things that are happening there and try to attach ourselves to that. It is difficult. I mean, I won't overstate this. I mean, basically the issue of when they're in a lease arrangement, these are not things that even in foreclosure that you'd be able to sell dollar for dollar. There's
no, I understand. The value goes downhill quickly on IT
correct.
Assets.
Correct. Right. So we can try to sort of, input into the agreement some kind of a way to keep close to any improvements that are going on.
It should be fairly straightforward. If a server... is this technology and it gets replaced with this technology, right. we would like to make sure that we still stay in a position if we're in first position on that piece of equipment that should be written into the agreement that whatever that next generation of technology is that we have a UCC filing on, that we should be able to keep current, because as a UCC filing gets satisfied, it comes off the books and the next one should go on.
Right.
And is our document designed to cover?
Well, the document isn't one size fits all. I mean, basically, it's a template we then negotiate. As I said, it's important to understand in this that basically we have now, if and when legislation is passed, we then have an arm wrestling stage to go through to sort of work all of that out and make sure that we're securitized, on the ground, and make sure that this is not just. Generalities. It's what are we talking about here?
Well, these will all be serial numbered products. More than likely, they're going to get filed.
Right.
And so, if something comes off the state record because it gets updated with a new server, we just make sure we keep our
keep
the same status that we're in right now. Jumpstart is indicated they're into about $500,000. Is any of that $500,000 that Jumpstart has provided the same money that we gave Jumpstart, so we're into this from two different fronts?
Okay, no,
so
not at all.
It has nothing to do with the Jumpstart loans?
It has nothing to do with the Jumpstart investment that we made into Jumpstart to do the pre-seed or the early stage loan programs.
Okay, very good.
This preceded that.
I just wanted to double check and make sure. And we're going to get monthly statements. Is that what you get, or quarterly statements we're getting?
A quarterly.
Okay. And then how many jobs, where does, if we're getting 50 jobs, does that cover our break even on the $500,000 plus interest?
It does.
In the 7 years?
Well, we've calculated a return on investment. It is in your packet. Basically, we have calculated the using actually our ROI tool and augmented by some tools that Team Neo and Greater Cleveland Partnership have assisted us with, basically to see what the multipliers are and to determine two things. One is real estate taxes that we'll be getting that will come out of this, but more importantly, the income taxes that will be coming out of this, which we've calculated, all of which, and then we actually do we go one step further and look at the indirect and induced jobs that come out of the jobs that are in this industry, to determine how many other jobs are flowing from this, and then calculate the tax revenue on that. All said and done, we're looking at 2.28.
How do we get real estate taxes?
And it's over 7 years.
How do we get real estate taxes out of this? Isn't this a
It's pretty minor. It's mostly income taxes. Yeah.
We've
done just a little bit conservatively. We figured if there's an improvement to the building, there's a tad of income taxes. Oh, okay. And there's sales tax that comes with the purchase of materials for construction.
Okay. And then to Mr. Simon's question, I don't see this as a place where they're going to use the Skills Up program. I mean, those are jobs that are $12 an hour going to 15 or 15 going to 20. These are, my understanding, these jobs have a lot of nice zeros on it.
Yeah, I can't speak to that, but I can say also, again, as is part of all of our economic development loan agreements, they are going to be signing a workforce development agreement that we have that would be in place with Ohio Means Jobs. In order for basically, if you recall, that tool has the borrower agreeing with Ohio Means Jobs that they will show them the list out of the staffing that will be taking place, and then Ohio Means Jobs will have a chance, not required, but a chance to offer up candidates for those jobs, at least for a look-see.
The value of $500,000, roughly rounding it out at 2%, and then forgiving it, that's probably worth all total by the time you roll up the interest, $750,000 to $800,000 that we're putting forward, if you fully balance it out over a 7 year period.
Yeah, except that we're not putting it forward. That's if you're saying if that's accruing interest and
right.
Somehow it's not cash that we're outlaying. So it's an accounting thing that would be having out at the same time. If we're clawing back the principal and the interest that would be accrued.
You're going to write the check for at what point along the way in this process?
Once they come in with bona fide invoices for the expenditures
for
that they've
all 48 employees.
Oh no! Okay,
no. They have to document.
That's the formula that gets us to the level of investment that we're willing to make. How many employees, and then we're not willing to go over costing ourselves $10,000 per employee with regard to the actual capital that we're giving them or loaning to them. That would come strictly from expenditures that they made that we would be reimbursing.
So the triggering event is the expense. The documentation that we will not claw back is if they maintain the employees for that length of time.
Correct.
Okay. Well, then we're going to be writing the check more than likely within the next 12 months, I would assume, someplace.
It's very likely and possible.
To that point,
it just seems like it would be a very appropriate time for Mr. Barrett to have a conversation. If you just had a great experience with his product in this building and the value of what those products would bring to us as to the value of what these significant amount of loans, perhaps would be a great place for have a conversation for an offset against the fact that the taxpayers are stepping up. Ordinarily, Most products are not necessarily something we have a direct use, but we also don't ordinarily write off what amounts to $500,000 plus 2%. So my suggestion is have a conversation before it's finalized. Is there any other questions? Okay.
Yes, one. Yep. I do have two comments, Mr. Chairman. One is, Mr. Barrett has a plane to catch, but two, in that regard, I neglected to request a expedited approval of this project because originally we were going down a BOC track, and so we had given a timeline for Mr. Barrett because one of the things he's held off on is starting to acquire and one sign his lease. To purchase, we told him he couldn't purchase any equipment until this was approved, or we wouldn't reimburse it. And so I don't know what the timing of this would be, but
I thoroughly intended to ask for that for an expedited for okay. second reading approval if everybody's in favor of it. I'm not going to put the motion on the floor, nor am I going to second it. Is there a motion for from someone in regards to moving this to the full council for a second reading approval?
I'll make that motion.
It's been moved and second. Been seconded. Okay. Any other discussion in regards to it? Hearing no other discussion, I will call for the vote and I will abstain on the vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
And one abstention. The motion carries. We had a quorum, so good luck. We'll be looking forward to that and congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Is there any miscellaneous business to come before this board? Hearing none, is there any public comment from anybody out in the audience? Thank you very much. This meeting is adjourned. Thank you.